usually when I give a lecture somewhere, I say I'm very glad to be here. And usually I am. This time it wouldn't be true. The only reason I'm here is because I promised to do so. And I certainly would not have come here if I had not promised, after seeing the voluminous literature which has been appeared in connection with this meeting. I am used to being told that I'm wrong. I'm used to being told that I'm too abstract. I'm used to people disagreeing with me. And sometimes I am wrong and am too abstract. I'm not clear. I'm not used to being called a liar, or being called incompetent, or being called a fascist. And this sort of thing makes me very unhappy to come to places where this is the nature of the kind of things going on. I was also warned, apparently unnecessarily, so far everything is behaving very well. I thought this is liable to be a shouting match rather than a debate. And I'm willing to concede right at the beginning that I'm not able to shout as loud as some others. I'm willing to bow out that this would be the kind of thing. However, I am here, and I am a teacher, and I like to teach. And so I will take a few minutes to talk about something which I know something about, I think, which I think I have some competence in spite of all the letters in the press here. And I will not try to deal with four problems, which is apparently what the people who organized the debate wanted me to do. Instead, I will try to lay down what seems to me the basic propositions of the nature of the new economic policy produced by President Nixon, and the things which I think it can achieve. One more word before I go on to that. In the course of the discussion, letters, and the broadside, I've also been accused of being a kind of sadist. That is, that I love to reduce the standard of living of the working people, to grind their faces in the dust, I think is the proper expression for this. That is because I have been against increasing wages, and in fact, on some occasions, I have proposed a decrease in wages. Now, in the context, this must be understood, that I did not believe ever that this decrease in wages would make the workers any poorer or have less things to eat. It was clearly understood that it was a decrease in money wages which would make it avoid the inflation, so that they would be just as well off with the wage, with the lower money wage, as with the higher money wage. The most important difference being that there would be more work for more people, which I am in favor of. But apparently, I thought this should not be necessary to emphasize, but apparently it is necessary, judging by the letters, etc. Now, what is the new economic policy? There are a few very simple propositions which seem to be disputed by the people who organized this meeting with arguments to which my normal response is, why don't you learn about economics? We're having an inflation which prices are rising. Inflation often happens because people are spending too much money trying to buy more than is available to be bought. Whenever this happens, the prices have to rise, and if that is the nature of the inflation, the cure for it is to remove the cause, which is usually the way of curing anything satisfactorily. And in this case, the cause would be that there is too much spending, and this can be done by the government taking money away from people so they shouldn't be able to spend so much, and then they'll be able to buy the same thing without the increase in prices. This, however, is not the nature of the inflation we are having now. It does not make sense to say that there is too much spending when we are having 6% unemployed, when we have managed not long ago with only 3.5% unemployed. We have more unemployed because the spending is not enough to buy all the goods which could be produced, which is why people are not producing them. So since the employer will not employ people to make goods to take out self, there is not enough spending. So we cannot say the inflation is due to too much spending. It is not due to something else. What it is due to is the power of the sellers, not of the buyers, to raise the prices. The workers raise the wages, the employers raise the prices. The employers agree to pay the higher money wages because they can pass it on in charging higher prices. And they each blame each other, and possibly even quite sincerely. The employers say we must raise the prices because our costs are going up, and they are, because the wages are rising. And the representatives of the workers say we must raise our wages because the prices are going up. And that is also true. And so we have each blaming each other, and you have to find out which came first, chicken or the egg, and of course there's no sensible answer in doing that. What needs to be done is to remove the cause. The cause is the pressure of wages and of prices to go up because of the bargaining power which the workers have and because of the market power which the businessmen have. And the attempt by the new economic policy is to curtail this power, the result of which would be to check the inflation. That is not the most important part of it. The thing is serious not because of the inflation, which at the present rate doesn't do any terrible harm. Other countries are managing with much greater inflation and having greater prosperity and employment, which is more important than that prices are rising. The really important thing is that the attempt to stop the inflation is taking place by people who think it is the first kind of inflation, that it is due to too much spending. And so measures have been taken by the government, by the central banks, to cut down on the total amount of spending on the ground that this is supposed to be the cause of the inflation. The result of that is that there is less spending, and there wasn't too much, and now there is too little. And so we have the unemployment as the worst result of the inflation, even though it is due to the cure rather than to the disease. But the cure is worse than the disease, and we are in a situation where, in order to remove the cure, we have to remove the disease. To remove the disease, we have to regulate wages and prices to stop them from rising the way they do. And if we succeed in that, we can then take measures to increase the total amount of spending, because there will not then be so many people who will say, you mustn't do that because it's inflationary. And then you will have more employment, more jobs for everybody, and this is the reason why I think it would be a good idea to check increases in wages and in prices. Now, I probably have used up the time which I have, or do I have some more time? Oh, good. What is needed then is to do something to stop this, and then we can have a policy of increasing the total amount of spending. Now these things are being done extremely badly by the present government. When the new economic policy was first spelled out, announced, it was included the suggestion that steps would be taken to increase personal spending, to increase the number of jobs. This has not been done. It was not done because of the very same pressures which brought about the depression in the first place. And people said, oh, it's inflationary to have a deficit. And so while the president tried to increase personal spending by cutting certain taxes, by no means the best taxes, he also was induced to cut certain expenditures so as to avoid too big a deficit. And these are things which I criticize the, what is being done. I'm also critical of many other things. But one thing which I do want to stress, again as a result of the enormous publicity and the kind publicity that this was given here, is that if I agree with something which somebody does, it is not true, and I think it is improper, indecent. For people to assume that therefore I agree with everything that those people do. Because I agree with the Nixon economic policy, it does not mean that I agree with the Vietnam War. Because I agree with what was done in Brazil to check the inflation, it doesn't mean I'm in favor of a fascist dictatorship, which they have there. And all those suggestions are the kind of thing which made me most reluctant to come here. But perhaps these were just a kind of rhetoric, and I think I can understand why that kind of rhetoric takes place. It takes place among people who are extraordinarily ignorant of economics, and at the same time, supremely confident that they have the answers which nobody else knows. I have not met my protagonist today. He looks like a decent gentleman. I have read a four newspaper column expounding his views. I found in that a number of quite keen insights, and also a number of quite extraordinary elementary mistakes in economics. I hope you will forgive me for plagiarizing it. I took a piece out of his article and gave it to one of my classes in their examination. Let me give you an illustration of this kind of argument, which makes me think that debating is not really the way to deal with this kind of issue. I used to go to debates a lot. I'm very fond of debating. I'm a bit out of practice now because I've been teaching instead. There's a vast difference between debating and teaching. The best debates are those which are completely meaningless. I remember a marvelous debate I once spoiled. The debate was as to whether all actions are selfish. And those in favor of it said, even if a mother gives away her last crust of bread to the child, she does it because that's what she wants to do, and therefore she's being selfish. And of course you can see this is a very useful sort of thing. The best debates are useless. They're more like the nature of a fight. They're very good for showing off your pyrotechnics and speech, and I enjoy that too. It's one of the sports which I go in for. But it is not enlightening. And I think that those who are interested in these topics would do much better, instead of having debates, to go and learn some economics, maybe read some books about it. Thank you.
Next speaker will be Lyn Marcus, revolutionary socialist, national chairman of the National Caucus of the Labor Committees, author of Third Stage Imperialism and Philosophy of Socialist Education, and a forthcoming work, Dialectical Economics. Mr. Marcus.
The trouble with he, which Professor Lerner doesn't seem to grasp, is that in the ordinary course of events, economic teaching in universities is more like the practice of a priesthood than anything to do with reality. It's simply something you learn, you don't use it in business much. Point of fact, most business economists or most practicing economics in business do not have an economics training, but usually an industrial engineering or some other type of training. However, in the course of a crisis, these abstractions, which are the priestly affairs of economic education, which you have to learn to pass the course primarily, become something more than abstractions. They become something relating to concrete policies which affect the lives of people. And they have consequences for people. And thus people who are too divorced from reality, seeing these abstractions merely as innocent intellectual toys, lack a grasp of the blood concreteness that these abstractions sometimes lead to in practice. And therefore, since the lives and well-beings of millions and even billions of people are at stake, that an error in the domain of abstraction is not an intellectual error. It can be a bloody crime against humanity. A professor who says innocently, the economy, from my point of view, would be better organized if certain administrative arrangements were made, does not necessarily think out to the kind of administrative arrangements which in practice realize that very innocent practice. Professor Lerner may attempt to divorce his economic policies from the policies of the government of Brazil and see them in abstraction and detachment from that. However, you cannot carry out the economic policies which are recommended for Brazil without having the kind of government which makes those economic policies work. You could not have the kind of policies which are recommended, which he's recommended as a classic austerity policy for increased unemployment. Now, it is classic in the sense that this is precisely the policy of Schacht from 1933 on in Germany, in which wages were frozen to prevent the inflation and in order to increase employment. He may personally detach himself from that, but it's not possible for the politicians to accept his advice to detach themselves from the kind of government and the kind of procedures which enable those abstractions to become reality. And that has to be grasped, because now no longer is economics merely a plaything of an obscure corner of the academic priesthood. Now economic policy is that which determines the lives and daily lives and conditions of people. The form of economic policy determines the kind of government which is necessary to carry it out. And the only kind of government which can carry out the kind of policy which Professor Lerner recommends in all well-meaning, all good intention, would have to be a Bonapartist or fascist government. He may be opposed to fascism with every fiber of his being. This was also true in Germany, where many economists, liberal economists, proposed austerity, were also opposed to the Nazi regime. But nonetheless, there are men who will take up these policies and carry them out, and they will be Bonapartists or fascists, but not Professor Lerner. So he must understand that sometimes his good intentions do not ensure that his policies carried into practice will work out as he sees them in human terms. Now, to put the whole problem into concrete focus, this is not a national problem, it's a world economic problem. Right now, whether there's a depression before Christmas or January, or one later in 1972, seems to hinge upon decisions which will be made, according to reports, 2 weeks from now in Washington, when the Group of Ten again meets, and attempt to see if they can come up with the kind of policy which is agreeable to both the Europeans, Japanese, and to that amateur economist, most amateur, from Texas, Treasury Secretary Connor. Now, what's the possibility? Because this tells you, the reason I go to this is because this is the only way you can understand what we're facing right here. What Connolly has proposed to do, finally, if his rhetoric means anything, is Connolly has proposed to do what, to a certain degree, what most rational economists would have proposed at August 15th in any case. And some degree of confidence which welled around the world as of August 15th was based on the assumption that the Nixon administration was going to finally do something of this sort. And then after several months, it became clear the Nixon administration was not. The Europeans called finally all sorts of bad names in public, which is not the sort of thing that parliamentarians would do. And Senator Javits in the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, began to say bad things about Treasury Secretary Connolly, too. And under tremendous pressure from banking circles in this country, as well as from Europe, finally the imminent catastrophe, which would flow from the continuation of Connolly's former policies, got home to the Nixon administration, maybe for political reasons rather than rational reasons, and finally they at least attempted to put a show of moving in the direction demanded by the Europeans, which is more or less rational from their standpoint. Would it solve the problem? It would not. What it would do is prevent an immediate depression. If, for example, 2 weeks from now, the Group of Ten came out with no meeting, with no agreement, then this would destroy confidence in the capitalist economy throughout the world, and it would mean blocs and sectors would tend to go each way, each trying to defend themselves against the effect of the competition from other sectors. In other words, an unraveling of the world economy and a world trade crisis, and an immediate replay, to the extent that there is any replay in history, of 1931 onward, particularly what happened about 6 months after the London or the British decision to float the pound in September 1931. What will happen probably is that they will at this stage agree, or at least we can assume that that's the most rational course of action for them, and it now seems that Connolly has finally gotten the word. There will probably be a 7 to 10% devaluation of the dollar, which means there has to be a gold devaluation in some term or other, otherwise it's meaningless. Otherwise, you simply have a float on top of a float, and there will be adjustments in other currencies. What the effect of this will be to turn the International Monetary Fund into something of an engine of inflation and stability in international trade. These people are not willing to go to what the abstract monetary and fiscal economists would recommend for the world at this stage, is to turn the IMF into, in fact, a central reserve system for the entire world, that is, all currencies, dollars and so forth, gold, will be turned over to the IMF, much the same way that gold was turned over to the Federal Reserve System in this country to get a stable currency. They won't do that for political reasons, but some approximation of that to make the SDRs a international reserve unit for trade to somewhat replace the dollars will be the probable course of events if the optimal variant is taken at the meeting 2 weeks from now. Now, would this mean, and most people who are sanguine about the results of such an agreement would argue that this is the case, does this mean that there is going to be a return to the conditions existing, say, before March of this past year when this unraveling process started, or does it mean that simply merely a postponement of this crisis for a short period of time until some new monetary break brings a repetition which is more difficult to cope with than the one of this past August, leading into an immediate depression? The latter possibility happens to be the more likely. The reason is simple, is that in order to maintain a stable world economy, all advanced sectors in some productive state, it would be necessary for the International Monetary Fund to begin to generate credit to take the place of the U.S. role in generating credit to sustain world trade and expansion over a previous period. The Connolly proposal to stabilize the world system by getting the other advanced sector nations to contribute first $13 billion, now reduced to $9 billion, to the U.S. balance of payments situation would not solve the problem. A stable U.S. currency based on that is a mayor's nest. It's a fool's errand. Because if the U.S. succeeds in extracting from the rest of the world even $9 billion in trade concessions, this means depressive conditions throughout the rest of the capitalist sector, particularly upon those sectors such as West Germany, Japan, the Dutch, which have the largest export component. Something very much like what happened to Germany and to other nations after 1929, particularly after 1931. So that to the extent that the U.S. stabilizes the dollar by this kind of short-term measure, accompanied perhaps by $30 billion repatriated from Europe into the U.S., which would be an inflationary measure, to that extent, there is absolutely no solution to the U.S. or to Europe, because to depress Europe and Japan, to create depression conditions in Europe and Japan, pulls the plug out under the entire international monetary system, and when that begins to go, the dollar goes with it. So what Connolly has proposed is no solution at all. Now this brings us to what Professor Lerner talked about. The monetary expansion process is no solution, precisely because the present crisis was caused by an exhaustion of the capacity for further monetary expansion of that type. And to attempt to return to it, except on a very modest basis for a short period, is impossible. So it comes down to, if you can't have an inflationary monetary expansion, where do you get the money with which to stabilize the capitalist system? That is, where do you get the funds to maintain the current required levels of profit, debt service, and rental payments throughout the capitalist system necessary to sustain the value of stocks, bonds, acceptances, and so forth? If you're not expanding the monetary system, then you must get the payments out of the existing monetary flow based on existing levels of production. This means that profit, debt service, and rent can be increased only at the expense of two other sectors. These are respectively primarily the wage sector and secondarily the farm sector. Therefore, what happens in a period like this is that in order to maintain the capitalist system, not the ability to produce, but in order to maintain the capitalist system, it dictates an assault primarily on wages for the purpose of increasing or maintaining payments to the account of profit, debt service, and rent. So the old classic class struggle, in which the general interests of working people and farmers to a lesser degree, because the attack on farmers will be somewhat less immediately, against those who represent the interests of profit on stocks, debt service on bonds and other forms of debt, acceptances and so forth, and rent, are locked in a struggle that one must survive at the expense of the other. Now you would say the false theory on which Professor Lerner's argument is predicated is that the cause of post-war inflation is the rise of wages of productive workers, especially trade union workers. This is essentially a nonsense argument. It is not the case. The thing which causes, there are two things which cause inflation, or this type of inflation, that tended to cause it since about 1870. That is, ask the question, if at the point of production, as opposed to average wage earners, the rate of increased productivity has been in the order of magnitude of 7% per annum, that's at the point of production, operatives only, not white-collar administrators and servants, then how is it that the cost of the commodities which are produced under these conditions of rising productivity do not decline, the price of commodities do not decline, rather rise? There's one simple reason, or there are two interrelated reasons. The first reason is the expansion of the monetary system and the growth of debt, that such that the major costs of inflation with the increased productivity, a productivity increase which is much greater than the rise in wages at the point of production, is due to the debt service and profits on purely fictitious instruments which is assigned as a burden to production. Thus, the major cost of, or the major reason for rising prices, for inflation, has nothing to do with wages as such, but has to do with debt service directly and indirectly put on production. A major part of this is, of course, the government financing, which through taxation, other measures, adds to this and becomes a per unit added charge to production. A further factor is that the structural features of the economy are changed to cause a structural inflation. That is, productive employment stagnates, as has been the case in the United States since 1953. Whereas the growth of administrative services tied to this apparatus of capital expansion, paper capital expansion, generates expansion in both administrative employment and in services which are key to wage levels and employment in administrative employment. This means that a major section of the U.S. population, wage earning population, is shifted from productive to non-productive employment. And these are the causes of inflation. Potentially, in terms of real economy, we could have a shift toward production, productive employment, and very easily solve this problem. We could only take the paper, which stands for fictitious values, the rising debt, which is essentially based on fictitious values, stock values, which are based on fictitious values, rents based on fictitious values. You have to take this out and burn it and reconstitute the economy. There's no reason we couldn't have full employment and full productivity. But when you accept the capitalist system, which means to accept the legitimacy, the juridical legitimacy of these instruments, these inflated, worthless instruments, stocks, bonds, mortgages, etc., and you demand that you maintain the integrity of these, what you're doing is you're asking to maintain the fictitious element of the economy at the expense of the productive element. And therefore, the reasoning becomes to depress wages, to gouge wages, in order to maintain payments on profit, debt service, and rent. And that's exactly what the fight is about. Now, the only solution, whatever Professor Lerner's intentions, and I'm not addressing myself to his intentions, is the kind of solution he's proposing is precisely the kind of solution which was discovered by the German financiers in 1933, was implemented by Schacht, to reduce wages, that is to fix them at the level of 1933, depression levels in Germany, as a means for expanding employment. And this is precisely the pattern I suggest throughout the world today.
I was delighted and surprised by Mr. Marcus's talk. I was expecting it more of it to be the kind of criticism which comes from the left, but about 50% of it was just the kind of argument which I was engaged in a long time ago in arguing against those people who were infatuated with gold. who believe that gold is the basis for everything. Now, most people, middle left, everybody except the extreme right, have given up this belief in gold. And this is possible because of their recognizing one thing which I did mention before. Essentially, the difference between cutting money wages and cutting real wages. Now, what I have been talking about, what I have proposed, what is Nixon's policy, does not involve the impoverishment of the workers. It does not mean austerity at all. It's a complete misunderstanding to take the holding down of money wages as meaning austerity. It means exactly the opposite. It means the prices will not rise, the money will not increase, and more people will have jobs. Now, can more people have jobs? There were people, especially in the 1930s, and they were responsible for the Great Depression of the 30s, who said it is wicked, it is wrong, it is impossible to create more money unless there is gold buried somewhere to back it. We have escaped from that, and one of the evidences of this escape was the fact that from 1961 till 1969, we had the longest period of maintained prosperity in this country that ever existed. A lot of workers or the fruit of farmers. If there's a shortage of money, you can print money. This was a great discovery of Keynes, which I've been active in teaching students for a long time. I may be wrong, and I'm going to listen to arguments. But the complicated arguments put forward today are based upon a mix-up of the ancient superstitions of the classical economists, somehow tied into saying this is due to capitalism. I would agree with that if by capitalism I mean the kind of behavior or policy which was responsible for the depression of the 30s. We said we must not print any more money, even if it is needed, because we don't have the gold. Now, among the people who escaped from this, and I'm afraid I can't help it, was Adolf Hitler, who in fact increased prosperity in Germany, gave people jobs, and he did so. I don't think it is funny, but it was very unfortunate, because these good things led to people supporting him to do the terrible things he did afterwards. But I cannot refrain from saying that these things that he did do that, he did. This kind of argument I don't like.
Right on with it.
Thank you.
Actually, there's a confusion about the goal, which I'll deal with, but particularly I'll just make 2 points. First of all,